of you. Warm welcome. First things first, these weapons of mass disturbance, so please ensure they are switched off or on mute. Okay, my name is Rudra Sen Sharma. I am the chairman of the research office at IIM Kozhikode. Let me first very warmly welcome our guest of honor, Professor Madhav Gadge. And also let me welcome Professor Kulbhushan Baluni, our director in charge. I'll just quickly tell you the format. Professor Baluni is going to introduce the speaker who needs no introduction, but still we will sort of introduce the talk and him to you. And then Professor Gadgil will give his talk, followed by question and answers, which I'll tell you about after the talk. Some people were asking me the reason for having this talk. You know, business schools are associated with profits and corporate aggression, but I think our institute, IIM Kozhikode, is a business school with a difference. And from the very beginning, our mission has been to be sensitive towards society and the larger ecosystem that we live in. So one of our main purposes is to create managers for the industry and economy who will be sensitive towards the environment and the larger society. You may be interested, sir, to know that we have compulsory courses in environmental management and compulsory courses in business ethics and a compulsory course in social transformation of India. Our campus is also a very environmental friendly campus. I think you have seen that we do rainwater harvesting, which minimizes the use of outside water for all our needs. We have a campus green initiative committee who in the last 2 years have planted more than 700 trees in our campus, and they are very strict. I am told if you want to touch a single tree, you have to take their formal approval. These new trees are irrigated also from rainwater harvesting, so no new water is used. And in fact, I am told we are building a new pond to be a water source, which is also being done using some new technology where cement use is going to be minimized and the natural character of the place is going to be leveraged to build that pond. So I think it's very appropriate for us to have the talk from Professor Gadgil. I'll just ask our director in charge, Professor Baluni, to welcome Professor Gadgil once more with a bouquet. Now I invite Professor Baluni to formally welcome and introduce Professor Gadgil.
Thank you, Professor Rudra, for introducing the campus. I'm introducing Professor Madhav Gadgil as his student in absentia. Whatever we do, all the work actually is all based on the framework of Professor Madhav Gadgil. And I'm very happy. I would like to say that I think this is one of the big event for me also, especially, and otherwise also. And at the outset, I thank Professor Rudra for organizing a wonderful program, and so many people have come. And my special welcome to all the citizens of Kozhikode city who are here, and it's a big number. I'm going to introduce Professor Madhav Gadgil in divided into two parts of my presentation. One is the formal one where I read his qualification, his experience, his awards, and the second one, the informal one, where I'll be, I think, more passionate, and I'll put more energy there. I think a teacher can be best described by his student. I think that's the best introduction of a teacher. And I'll describe Professor Madhav Gadgil in the beginning in the words of one well-known ecologist called Deval Dev. He undertook his postdoctoral research under Professor Madhav Gadgil at IIC. He calls Professor Madhav Gadgil as the grandmaster of formal ecology and the founder of Center for Ecological Sciences at the Indian Institute of Sciences. I can tell you that today, the Center for Ecological Sciences in IIC Bangalore I think it's the top five ecological sciences institutions in the world. And they are producing wonderful PhDs. And recently, one of my contemporary, I think I'm just not getting a name, got the Nobel Elinor Ostrom Prize. Harini, I'm sorry. She's a good friend of mine, I forgot that. She got, in the name of Harini Ostrom, who was a Nobel laureate in economics 3 years back, 4 years back. And what has been instituted for a senior researcher. And she was the one, first one to get that award. So this is a kind of institution Professor Madhav Gargil has created. About his qualifications, Professor Madhav Gargil has a PhD in the area of mathematical ecology from Harvard University. He's been an IBM Fellow of the Computing Center's Research Fellow in Applied Mathematics and a lecturer in biology at Harvard University. He was on the faculty of Institute of Science, Bangalore, where he founded a Center for Ecological Sciences. He's currently D.D. Kosambi, visiting researcher professor in interdisciplinary studies at Rouen University. He has also served as a visiting faculty at Stanford and as a distinguished visiting lecturer at the University of California, Berkeley. He's a fellow of the Indian Academy of Sciences, Indian National Sciences Academy, Third World Academy of Sciences, a foreign associate of US National Academy of Sciences, and an honorary member of British Ecological Society. He is a recipient of Padma Shri and Padma Bhushan, Shanti Sarup Bhatnagar, and Vikram Sarabhai Awards, and Volvo Environment Prize, among others. He was a member of the Science Advisory Council to the Prime Minister of India from 1986 to 90, and chaired the Science and Technology Advisory Panel of Global Environmental Facility from 1988 to 2002. Professor Madhav Gargil has worked on the committee that drafted the Biological Diversity Act 2002 and has developed the methodology and the database for people's biodiversity registers that has been recommended for countrywide adaptation by the National Biodiversity Authority. I think I would like to focus here particularly. I think this is one area which has been overshadowed by the recent report of Professor Madhav Gargil on Western Ghats. But this is one area in the case of biodiversity conservation. I think India has shown the rest of the world the way how to conserve biodiversity. Now we have this called biodiversity registered at the vigilant panchayat level, where we put an inventory what kind of species we have, and that helps in protecting our regions also. And I think this is a very, very important contribution of Professor Madhav Gargil. And he was also a member of the group that prepared the National Curriculum Framework 2005, and is currently chairing the committee to revise the environmental education curriculum at the school stage. He was the chairman of Western Ghats Expert Committee, which is popularly known as Gargil Committee. Professor Gargil's scientific interests focus on ecology and evolutionary biology, conservation biology, human ecology, natural resource management, and ecology, ecological history. He has published over 235 scientific papers and 6 books, including this special land, Ecology and Equity, and I will try to focus on this particular book later on, and Ecological Journeys. He has developed strong traditions of working with researchers, teachers, and policymakers, as well as NGO workers, farmers, and other citizens throughout the country. And I think he has worked with a number of academicians from the different parts of the world, along with even people from NGOs and the farmers, and I'm quoting few of them. He has co-authored this paper with the Romila Thapar, the well-known historian, Ramachandra Guha, Charles Sperring, who's a well-known economist, Carl Fogge, a human ecology specialist, and K.M. Harvey, a farmer, among others. Now, my personal experience and what I've learned from him, and what my students are learning from Professor Madhav Gargil, I think most of the new human. As Professor Guha has mentioned that I've been teaching a course on environmental management, so what this course is about that. First of all, I think it's a bit of misnomer. It should be called as environmental management and governance. Now, when you look at this particular course which I've been teaching, the entire framework of this, at least I can say most of my sessions actually, they are built around the framework which has been given by Professor Madhav Gargil. And among the top, if you, I'm just trying to discuss my course, but outline, but that's very important. The first module, we discuss about sustainability, and that too from intergeneration equity. And I think and the best written work on intergeneration equity has come from Professor Madhav Gargil. With my students, I share a concept of Professor Gargil, who has, for intergeneration equity, he talks about three kinds of people. ecosystem people, ecological refugees, and the biosphere people. Biosphere people, we call them omnivores also. When you look at these three categories, he is trying to relate to people in all over the world, living beaten, local, and available, with the environment. And surely we can pose a question, who's responsible for environment? So this concept actually helps us. So basically, ecosystem people, which I'm sure Professor Malik Ragil is going to discuss in the large, but just to summarize that, it's about the people who are living in the villages and poor catchment areas small. They draw their resources from a small area. And then ecological refugees are one who have been uprooted from the villages because of degradation of the environment. They have no choice but to move to the urban areas. And then the people, all of us who are sitting here, we have access to resources all over the world, and we are to the biosphere. When I've been using this concept very well. When a book was published, a well-known book, the Booker Prize Award winner, The White Tiger, by Arvind Adiga. The moment I read the book, right from first page to the end page, what I found actually is all, when I was reading, I was just thinking of Professor Malik Ragil. This book is centered around, in the beginning, around a village called Lakshmangarh in Bihar. And the protagonist of this particular book is Balram Halwai. So this book talks about this Balram Halwai, who is a very, very ambitious person. I'm sure most of you have read this book. And then this person moves from, he's living in a small village, Lakshmangarh, limited resources, but an ambitious person. Then he moves to Dhanbad to work with some miner. And then, but he's still more ambitious, and he moves to Delhi. And Delhi, what he calls, he, from ecosystem person, he becomes ecological refugee. He lives in very, very bad condition over there, not in a clean place, as most of the people that live in the slums, but he's still more ambitious. He, from there, he moves to Bangalore and starts his own enterprise. And still, he's an entrepreneur now. He's running a, car hiring services, but he's ambitious. But at the same time, he has not given up his values. When I read that book, immediately I thought of that. I think I need to give this book to my students as a compulsory reading. And so I gave that book for almost 3 years as a compulsory reading. And once I have discussed these things, the students were clear that why I have given this book to you. And I thought I'm the only person using this book as a compulsory reading for this subject. Last year I was in Bangalore University, and I was talking to a sociologist, and we talked about Professor Ragil's work, and suddenly we talked about this White Tiger. And it happened that other colleague also in Netherlands, she was also using that book as a compulsory reading. So look at actually like, this is how I'm relating the work of Professor Malik Ragil Jawlani. And I'm telling my students that we have learned a lot. We don't learn from Professor Jawlani, we learn from Professor Malik Ragil. And another a very, very important part of my course that focuses on, it's an interdisciplinary course. I touch upon sociology, anthropology, sustainable economics, everything. And one module we discuss about institutions and about property rights, collective action, social capital. And I begin that module with a case study of Kumta. The moment I say Kumta, I'm sure my students know what I mean by Kumta. Kumta Taluk is there along the in the Dakshin Kannada district. And Professor Madhav Ghargal has described that village very well, where we learned about sustainability, sustainable economics, about traditional knowledge, and about social capital also. And sometimes students, they wonder, teacher is giving a same case study year after year after. Why he's not working hard, actually? He's not producing any case study. But I would like to tell you that sometimes we are compelled, because there is no substitute for that particular case study. So I would say that this is a kind of knowledge Professor Madhav Ghargal has created. Now let me talk about his contribution at the national level. Recently, the recent issue of, or this issue of The Economist has come. An article has come, a very, very nice article has come. Tropical forests, a clearing in the trees. New ideas on what speeds up deforestation and what's closing down. This article basically talks about some of the countries like Mexico, Costa Rica, India, which have, without any external help, at their own also, and beautifully, using policy instruments, they have stopped forest degradation and they have recovered the forest, in other words. And this article speaks very highly of India also. And when you look at the recent literature all over the world about in good journals, Indian efforts are really, really appreciate them. Now the question is that who is behind those efforts? Is it that ISO office of Indian Water Service officers, IS services, people from IS services? They contribute that. Definitely they contribute. But from where the information comes? Actually, information. I would like to specify two policies which have changed the course of India. One was definitely the Forest Conservation Act, 1980s, which was, in a way, actually, I can say that our ex-chief, Prime Minister Indira Gandhi has contributed a lot for implementing that policy. But later on, the National Forest Policy and the recent Forest Rights Act, 2006, it all talks about decentralized governance. And India has, I can tell you, and this policies all work on the basis of Professor Madhav Bagel and his contemporaries. His seminal work on non-timber forest produce is very, very important for framing this policy. So what was happening after independence, all the policies they came, they were all focusing on timber only, that we get only timber from the forest. Professor Madhav Bagel has shown that non-timber forest products are also important. They contribute a lot to the village economy. So what I'm trying to say, these are the inputs, and that is how we form these policies. And today, we talk about decentralized governance, and this model actually, all over the world, in any developing countries, I have been, as a postdoctoral student, I have traveled to some of the Southeast Asian countries, like Vietnam, Laos, Philippines, and what I found there, almost the entire Indian policies have been adverbative, taken and implemented there. And this is the, I think, the one of the most important contributions. And this contribution of the policy making process is also going into framing the global warming policies for adapting and for mitigating greenhouse gases. So I'm sure Professor will is going to elaborate a lot on these issues. I just conclude with the two phrases which I learned while learning about policy science. One phase we use policy analysis, and the other phase we use analysis for policy. And what happens most of the time? We focus on policy analysis. We forget about that. Analysis for policy is more important, and that is the contribution of Professor Madhav Bagel. And in the context of Western Ghat report, if you see this report, I'll officially go through the report. Everything, but all the kind of instruments, whether in the market or not market instruments we are using, the decentralized governance we are talking, all the inputs are there. It's a very, very elaborate document. Best is up to us, to the rest of the society, that we take it or not take it, but we have to look it from a very, very pragmatic view. So, and I just want to request to Madhav Bagel, if you can just speak about the myths and realities about corporate issues and responsibility to my students. Myths and realities of CSR. Thanks. Thank you.
Now may I invite Professor Mar-